Good morning, students. Welcome to Best College online classes. In this video lectures, we are going to discuss about human reproductive system. In the part of that, in previous classes, already we discussed about various concepts that are related to human reproductive system. In that, in last class, we discussed about female reproductive system. In the female reproductive system, we already completed the discussion about primary sex organs or gonads, that are a pair of ovaries. And after completion of that, we are discussing secondary sex organs or accessory sex organs. In that, first we are discussing accessory ducts. In female reproductive system, what are the accessory ducts present? A pair of fallopian tubes or oviducts, a single uterus, a cervix, and a vagina are present. In that, already we discussed about fallopian tubes and oviducts. Now we have to discuss about the uterus. You all know that already I gave you some information about the uterus in the last class. In this class, we will continue the same topic, uterus first, and after that we will go for remaining accessory ducts. So here, uterus, which is also known as womb. Uterus or womb, or it is also known as metra or hystera. Already I gave you all that in last class. Okay, uterus or womb or metra or hystera, I gave you where this uterus is located. It is actually inverted pear shape, elastic bag-like structure, inverted pear-shaped elastic bag-like structure that is located in between rectum of large intestine and urinary bladder. So in female, the womb or uterus is located in between urinary bladder and rectum, and it is an inverted pear-shaped structure. It is elastic bag-like structure. We can say this is the widest part in the female reproductive system. And in the uterus, what are the parts that are present that we will discuss now? So here, observe, it is the inverted pear-shaped structure, that is uterus. Here in the uterus, as already I gave you, there are three parts: fundus, carina, and carpus. Fundus, carina, carpus are the three parts in the uterus. So here, the anterior most dome shape structure is fundus. The anterior most dome shape structure is fundus. And next to the fundus, carina is present. It is the part actually where the uterine part of fallopian tube, that is isthmus of fallopian tubes, opens here like this. So where actually fallopian tubes are opening into the uterus, that is the carina. And the main part of uterus or womb is carpus. We can expect majority of the embryonic development, and most of the time the embryo or fetus will stay here. Okay, so majority of the development takes place here. Fundus is anterior most dome like structure. Here the implantation will be expected. Implantation will be expected. But later, if you see here, carina, it is a part of uterus which receives fallopian tubes. And the major part in the uterus is carpus. And already I gave you the neck of uterus is cervix. Neck of uterus is cervix, and this opening is vagina. So this is vagina, and this is the vaginal orifice or vaginal opening, right? So that you have to remember primarily in the structure of uterus. And after this, we have to discuss about the layers that present in the wall of uterus. What are the layers that present in the wall of uterus? If you see, it is a inner layer, for example, and outside to this, one more layer is there. At last, the most exterior, there is also another layer. So like this also. So how many layers are there in the wall of uterus? In the wall of uterus, there are three layers. In the wall of uterus, there are three layers: outer layer, middle layer, and inner layer. So these are the three layers that present. Is it visible? So like that, there are three layers. So outer layer, the outermost layer here is perimetrium. Perimetrium. The middle layer, myometrium. Myometrium. And the inner layer, endometrium. Endometrium. So the wall of uterus has three layers: perimetrium, myometrium, and endometrium. Perimetrium, myometrium, and endometrium are the three layers there. Also, there are three layers: perimetrium, myometrium, and endometrium are the three layers that present here. Right. Now, the outermost layer is perimetrium. This layer is also known as serosa or adventitia. We can call perimetrium as a serosa or adventitia. So the outermost layer in the wall of uterus or womb is perimetrium, which is also known as serosa or adventitia. Maybe you all know that the serosa, you studied in many organs or many systems. So this serosa is mainly for the external covering. So it externally covers and protects the uterus. And after that, myometrium. Myometrium. See, myology. What is myology? What is myo means? Myo means muscle. Myology is a branch of biology that deals with the study of muscles. Okay. So myometrium is mainly made up of smooth muscles. Myometrium is made up of smooth muscles. Important. Myometrium is made up of smooth muscles. It is made up of smooth muscles. The largest smooth muscle in the body of a female is identified in the myometrium during the pregnancy. During the pregnancy, here the largest smooth muscles are present in the body. So in female, where you can find the largest muscle or the largest smooth muscle, that is in the myometrium. So the largest smooth muscles we can notice in the myometrium during the pregnancy. What is the role of these smooth muscles that present here in the myometrium? The smooth muscles which are present in the myometrium undergo very strong contractions during the parturition, which causes for pushing of a fetus exterior from the uterus. So which play a vital role in the parturition or delivery? That is the smooth muscles of myometrium. These smooth muscles of myometrium push the fetus out from the uterus after completion of gestation periods by the action of an hormone, that is oxytocin. By the action of oxytocin, it pushes the fetus out after a parturition that you have to remember here. Is it clear? So here myometrium is the middle layer. This layer is essential. Myometrium is a middle layer. This layer is essential. So here myometrium is the middle layer present in the wall of uterus. It is mainly made up of smooth muscles. These smooth muscles undergo very strong contractions that causes for labor pains, and also that pushes the fetus out from the uterus of the mother to the exterior. So that is parturition or delivery. So which layer of uterus play an important role in the parturition? Myometrium, by the action of oxytocin hormone. The smooth muscles which are present in the myometrium undergo very strong contractions that leads to labor pains, and finally that push the fetus out from the uterus. Okay, so that is the importance of myometrium. Myometrium is the middle layer of wall of uterus. It is mainly made up of smooth muscles. We can identify the largest smooth muscles in the myometrium during pregnancy of a female, and by the action of oxytocin, these smooth muscles undergo very strong contractions that leads to labor pains, and finally that pushes out the fetus from the uterus of the mother to the exterior. That is known as parturition or delivery. Right. So that's clear about the middle layer. And next to this, the endometrium. Endometrium. It is the innermost layer, and it is made up of glandular epithelium. It mainly contains many cylindrical glands. So it is mainly made up of glandular tissues. Glandular epithelium. It is made up of glandular epithelium, and this is a layer which provides a surface for the implantation. Where implantation takes place? In the inner layer, innermost layer of the uterus, that is endometrium. So implantation of blastocyst takes place in the endometrium, and it is the glandular layer. It contains many cylindrical glands. Okay, so it contains cylindrical glands that secretes various fluids, various nutritive fluids that are essential for the maintenance of all this endometrium layer. And after that, this is a layer which undergoes cyclic changes in menstrual cycle. In every menstrual cycle, it undergoes cyclic changes. See, from the age of puberty in human being, there are cyclic changes takes place in the endometrium of the uterus. It is mainly under the influence of hormonal levels in the body. See, if there is any reduce in the levels of hormones, especially if the progesterone levels will be reduced in the body, this endometrium will be degenerated. If the hormone levels will again increases, automatically this endometrium will be regenerates. So here, this is the layer which undergo a repeated degeneration and regeneration in every menstrual cycle. The degenerated part of this endometrium will send out through the vagina in the form of menstrual flow. The degenerated parts, along with the damaged capillaries, tissues, and blood, all that will be sent out through vaginal opening or vaginal orifice, which is known as menstrual flow. So, which is the layer that undergoes cyclic changes in every menstrual cycle in female? Endometrium, and it possesses glandular tissues or cylindrical glands are present here, and it is the site of implantation. In every menstrual cycle, except during the pregnancy, in every menstrual cycle, from the menarche to menopause, this endometrium undergoes cyclic changes. If the hormonal levels will be reduced, this endometrium will be degenerated. Whenever hormone levels will again increases, automatically the regeneration or reformation of endometrium will takes place. But the regeneration of endometrium, estrogen play an important role. In the degeneration, the levels of progesterone are essential. And whenever progesterone levels will be greatly reduces, it will undergo degeneration. Whenever there is a release of estrogen will again causes for regeneration, and after regeneration, to maintain this throughout the pregnancy, there is a hormone required, that is the progesterone. So which maintain endometrium throughout the pregnancy without degeneration, that is the progesterone. If there is any sudden drop in the progesterone level during pregnancy, what will happens? That leads to degeneration of endometrium that causes for abortions. So that we have to remember, it is the inner layer where the actual implantation takes place, and it is a layer which is in direct contact with the fetus. Okay, this layer will undergo repeated changes or cyclic changes in every menstrual cycle. That you have to keep in your mind, right? So that is about uterus. Is it clear? Right, uterus. If there is any infections or cancers to uterus, this uterus will be surgically removed. The surgical removal of uterus is known as hysterectomy. Hystera, also other name of this uterus, no? Hysterectomy, the surgical removal of hysterectomy, the surgical removal of uterus. Hysterectomy, surgical removal of uterus is known as hysterectomy. So that you have to keep in your mind. Right. Next, after completion of uterus, what is the next access index we have to discuss here is cervix. We have to discuss cervix. Next is cervix. Okay, so in this already I told you cervix is the neck of uterus. Here in this diagrammatic representation of zones, I already drawn here the cervix. So this is the neck of uterus is known as cervix. But here inside the cervix, there is a canal, or there is a cavity which is known as cervical canal. So here it is the cervix, and this cervix, it is the uterus. Uterus opens into cervix. And this cervix has a canal, that is the cervical canal. So this is the cervical canal. The cavity or space or the canal which is present inside the cervix is cervical canal. And if you observe the cervix, there are two openings, internal opening and external opening. Internal opening receives the uterus, and the external opening opens into vagina. The external opening opens into vagina. Here, So like this. So here it is a vaginal opening, right? So which opens into vagina? That is the external opening. The internal opening of this suffix is known as internal os. Internal os. The external opening is external os. So here, cervix is the neck of uterus. Cervix is the neck of uterus. It has a cavity inside it that is known as cervical canal, and it has two openings: an internal opening and a external opening. The internal opening here is the internal opening is internal os, and the external opening is external os. So that I have to keep in your mind. Let's clear about this. Right. Next, after completion of that. Next to that, is it clear? Okay. So that is about cervix. Next, after completion of cervix, what is the next part that is the that we have to discuss here is the vagina. Vagina. Okay, you all know that vagina is the copulatory organ of female reproductive system. Vagina is a tubular copulatory organ. So during the copulation, that is sexual intercourse between male and female, this vagina receives the penis and semen. Okay, vagina is tubular female copulatory organ. This receives penis during copulation and semen during insemination. Okay, that we have to remember, right? So vagina is tubular female copulatory organ. It receives penis and semen from the male human being, okay, during copulation. And after that, inside this vagina, there are transverse folds. Vagina has transverse folds like this. These transverse folds are known as vaginal rugae. Vaginal rugae. So here, vaginal rugae are the transverse folds present inside the vagina, and these transverse folds causes for formation of a rough surface inside the vagina. Okay, so inside the vagina there are transverse folds. That transverse folds are known as vaginal rugae. This increases the roughness, or it create a rough surface inside the vagina. Okay, that you have to remember here. And one more important thing here: after first parturition, this vaginal rugae will become soft, and there is a reduce in the roughness of vagina. Okay, after first parturition, the vaginal rugae will become soft. That you have to remember here. And this vagina will become thick after puberty. The thickness of vaginal wall will increases after puberty, and it possesses more glycogen. more glycogen will be present. So the thickness of wall of vagina will increases after puberty. After the age of 10 to 12 years in female, the thickness of wall of vagina will increases and it possesses more glycogen. It has it contain more glycogen, and vaginal rugae are transverse folds that are present in the inner wall of the vagina, and this becomes soft after first parturition. Okay, and also it possesses some glands that secretes some acidic fluids. Okay, so vagina is a acidic medium that you have to remember. The female copulatory organ, that is vagina, is a acidic medium. Why it is acidic in nature? The glands which are present in this vagina that will secrete acidic fluids. That acidic fluids will maintain an acidic medium or acidic nature of this vagina. Why it is acidic in nature? What is the importance of this acidic nature of vagina? So whenever there is a acidic pH, the microorganisms cannot able to grow. So to avoid the growth of any microorganisms, here it maintains acidic environment. Okay, in this acidic conditions, no microorganisms can survive, or that cannot be multiply, and that cannot increases. Okay, so because of that only, vagina is always acidic in nature. So in acidic environment, there is no chances of survival of living cells. Okay, because of that only, even the sperm, if that will enter into acidic vagina, that cannot able to survive. So before insemination or before releasing of spermatozoa into vagina, it should be neutralized. Because of that only, the seminal plasma is alkaline in nature. I gave you the pH of semen, 7.3 to 7.35. No, whenever that semen will releases into the vagina, it is acidic environment. There, it is alkaline. So that neutralizes the acidic medium. Then only the spermatozoa will be survive in the female genital tract. Okay, that you have to remember here about the vagina. And the external opening of this vagina, vaginal orifice or female genital pore. The external opening, for example, it is vaginal orifice or female genital pore. Vaginal orifice or female genital pore is the external opening of vagina. The external opening of a vagina is vaginal orifice or female genital pore. This female genital pore or vaginal orifice is partially covered by a thin membrane. Vaginal orifice or vaginal opening is partially, it is partially covered by, for example, if it is not clear here, observe here, if it is vaginal opening, it is partially covered by a thin membrane like this. Vaginal opening or vaginal orifice is partially covered, or it is covered by a thin membrane which is partially perforated. A partially perforated membrane covers the vaginal opening, which is known as hymen. What is hymen? The partially perforated thin membrane that covers the vaginal opening or vaginal orifice is known as hymen. Write down, what is hymen? The partially perforated thin membrane that covers vaginal orifice or vaginal opening is known as hymen. The partially perforated thin membrane that covers the vaginal opening or vaginal orifice. Vaginal opening or vaginal orifice is known as hymen. Very important definition. What is hymen, ma? The partially perforated thin membrane that covers that covers vaginal orifice or female genital pore or vaginal opening is known as hymen. During first coitus, or first copulation or first sexual intercourse, this hymen will tar. So hymen will tar during the first coitus, at the time of copulation, when the penis will enters into the vagina, at that time this hymen will be torn. Hymen will be torn during first coitus or first copulation. Okay, that you have to remember. But this hymen may also torn by sudden fall or while playing some games like horse riding, jumping, climbing. In that conditions also hymen may torn. So usually hymen will tar during the first coitus, but there are some other chances for tarn of this hymen by sudden fall or jar or at the time of climbing or at the time of jumping or at the time of horse riding or bicycling. At that time also hymen may tarn. So the presence or absence of hymen is not at all a reliable indicator of virginity of a person. All a reliable indication for the virginity of a person, because this hymen may turn during the first coitus, but there are some other chances also there. In that conditions also it may turn. If a person will suddenly fall, or at the time of climbing, or at the time of bicycling. So in that conditions also this hymen may turn. So the presence or absence of hymen is not at all a reliable indicator of virginity of a person. Okay, so that you have to remember about the hymen. So up to that, almost all the accessory ducts are completed here, that you have to remember. See, if you observe here carefully, it is the wall of cervix and it is the wall of vagina. Okay, in between this vaginal wall and cervical wall there is a gap. So the gap which is present in between cervical wall and the vaginal wall is known as fornix. It is fornix. Fornix is the gap between cervical wall and the vaginal wall, or the space between the wall of cervix and the wall of vagina. Here if you observe, it is the wall of cervix and it is the wall of vagina. In between them there is a space. The space between the wall of vagina and wall of cervix is known as fornix. That is the fornix. And one more thing you have to remember, inside the vagina there is a space. We can call that as a vaginal cavity. So here already I gave you cervical canal. So the cervical canal and vagina or vaginal cavity collectively forms birth canal. What is birth canal? The cervical canal and the vaginal cavity collectively forms a passage for the parturition of fetus. That is birth canal. So birth canal includes both the cervical canal and vaginal cavity, or cervical canal and vagina collectively forms birth canal. Okay, observe here, cervical canal and vaginal cavity both together form a passage for the parturition of fetus, which is present in the uterus, that will be sent out through the cervical canal and vaginal canal or vaginal cavity. Both collectively forms birth canal. What is birth canal? The cervical canal and vaginal cavity collectively forms a passage for the parturition of fetus. That is known as birth canal. Is it clear? Right. So that clear about all the accessory ducts in the female reproductive system. axis redux in female reproductive system. Is it clear? Right. After completion of that, one more thing we have to remember: majority of the axis redux in the female reproductive system, fallopian tubes, uterus, cervix, and upper part of vagina, are mainly developed from Bullerian ducts of mesonephrons. Very important. Accessory ducts in female reproductive system are developed from which duct? Bullerian duct. Bullerian ducts of mesonephron. Already I told you in male reproductive system there Wolfian ducts I gave you. Wolfian ducts. Here Mullerian ducts I am giving you. So in the early embryonic stages up to formation of metanephric kidneys, there are mesonephrons for the excretion. For the excretion, mesonephrons are present. The mesonephrons has two type of ducts: Wolfian ducts and Mullerian ducts. In male human being, Wolfian ducts will develop by the influence of testosterone as accessory ducts. So by the influence of testosterone in male human being, Wolfian ducts develops as accessory ducts. And in male, there is anti-Mullerian hormone. That anti-Mullerian hormone suppresses the development of Mullerian ducts. So Mullerian duct will be degenerated. In male, which will be degenerated, Mullerian ducts will be degenerated, but Wolfian ducts will modify into the accessory ducts. In male, Wolfian ducts will modify into accessory duct by the influence of which hormone? Androgen, that is testosterone. But in male, there is anti-Mullerian hormone present. That anti-Mullerian hormone suppresses the development of Mullerian ducts. So this Mullerian ducts will be slowly degenerated, but whereas in female there is no anti-Mullerian hormone develop into accessory ducts, that you have to remember. So in female reproductive system, Mullerian ducts will develop as a accessory ducts like oviducts or fallopian tubes, uterus, cervix, and upper part of vagina, all are developed from the Mullerian ducts. What about the Wolfian duct in female? For the development of Wolfian duct, testosterone hormone is required. In female body, testosterone hormone is absent. Because of that, here Wolfian ducts are degenerated and Mullerian ducts will develop as a accessory ducts, that you have to remember. Whereas in male, by the influence of testosterone, Wolfian ducts will develop as a accessory ducts, and by the action of anti-Mullerian hormone, Mullerian ducts will be degenerated. But here opposite, due to absence of testosterone, Wolfian ducts will be degenerated. Mullerian duct, due to absence of anti-Mullerian hormone, this Mullerian ducts will develop as a female accessory ducts. Accessory ducts in female reproductive system, both are important. So in male reproductive system, how accessory ducts are developed? Accessory ducts are developed by Wolfian duct by the influence of testosterone. What about female? In female, Mullerian ducts develops as a accessory ducts, right? So that's clear about accessory ducts in female reproductive system. Accessory ducts are completed, right? So what we discussed here, we discussed about the uterus, structure of uterus, location of uterus, and function of uterus, we all know that. Okay, so uterus is the site of implantation and embryonic development. It will provide nourishment for the fetus throughout the embryonic development, and also this uterus is essential for the parturition. Without myometrial muscles, okay, parturition cannot take place. Okay, so from the implantation to completion of gestation period, all the requirements will be provided by this uterus, and there is the formation of placenta also in between fetus and endometrium, inner wall of uterus, that are also okay. All right. Is it clear? Is it clear? Right. Now, already I told you there are some tissues or peritoneal tissues that attaches this accessory ducts to dorsal body wall. I told you ovaries are attached to dorsal body wall by mesovarium, and after that fallopian tubes are attached to dorsal body wall by mesosalpinx, and uterus is attached to dorsal body wall by mesometrium. So the three are important one. Ovaries are attached to dorsal body wall by mesovarium, a double fold of peritoneum. So ovaries are attached to dorsal body wall by a double fold of peritoneum known as mesovarium. Fallopian tubes are attached to dorsal body wall by a double fold of peritoneum known as mesosalpinx. Once again I am repeating, what is mesosalpinx? Mesosalpinx is a double fold of peritoneum that attaches fallopian tubes to dorsal body wall, that prevents the displacements of this. Always this accessory ducts have to be in its position. So to avoid the displacement, this will attach to the dorsal body wall. So how the fallopian tubes attaches to dorsal body wall? Just a student asked this, what is the mesosalpinx? Because of that I am giving you again. These are the fallopian tubes, and these fallopian tubes attached to dorsal body wall. For example, it is a dorsal body wall. These are attached to dorsal body wall by a double fold of peritoneum. The double fold of peritoneum which attaches fallopian tubes to dorsal body wall is known as mesosalpinx. Is it clear? Mesosalpinx, a double fold of peritoneum that attaches fallopian tubes to dorsal body wall is mesosalpinx. And one more doubt also there from a student, that is, what is the tubectomy? Already I gave you clearly, to avoid the production of children, to stop production of children, there is a surgical operation for fallopian tubes. In this process, fallopian tubes will be cut and tied. So when there is cutting and tying of these fallopian tubes, there is no chances for meeting of spermatozoa and ova. So here sperm cannot able to reach the ovum, which is present here. It is a sperm, it has to reach the ovum here, then only fertilization takes place. Now here it is cut and tied, otherwise sometimes there is a direct tying, a tight tying that avoid the entry. So sometimes that may chances of failure. Because of that, they'll cut and tie, they'll remove a small portion in the fallopian tube and they will tie this both ends. Then the sperm cannot able to meet the ovum, so there is no chances for fertilization and pregnancy. So it is a permanent sterilization of female. Tubectomy is a surgical operation for fallopian tubes, where fallopian tubes will cut and tie that avoid the meeting of sperm and ovum. Then there will be no chances of fertilization. Okay, it is a permanent sterilization, a permanent birth control. There is no chances for the production of children again if a person will go for this tubectomy. Is it clear? What is mesosalpinx and tubectomy? Mesosalpinx, a double fold of peritoneum that attaches fallopian tubes to dorsal body wall. Tubectomy, the surgical operation of fallopian tubes, where fallopian tubes will cut and tie provide the meeting of sperm and ovum that avoid fertilization. It is a permanent birth control method, or it is permanent sterilization. If once a person will go for this, then there will be no chances for the production of children again. Okay, so that you have to remember. And after completion of this accessory ducts, we have to discuss about accessory glands. But before going to discuss the accessory glands in the female reproductive system, first you have to know about external genitalia, because to identify the exact locations of accessory glands, first you have to know external genitalia here. Now I will give you the external genitalia. External genitalia. Okay, right. The external genitalia. See, up to now we are discussing only about the male and female reproductive systems. Still, I didn't give you about the gametogenesis. That is the production of spermatozoa in male. That is spermatogenesis. Production of ova in female. That is oogenesis. I didn't give you that. Along with that, I didn't give you the fertilization. I told you the sperm can be survive a maximum of 1 month in the epididymis, right? But this spermatozoa will survive a maximum of 24 to 48 hours in the female reproductive tract. In many books they mention 24 hours now. So 24 to 48 hours is the maximum lifespan of a sperm in female genital tract. That we will discuss at the time of discussing fertilization. But I didn't give you that. Some students are asking. So I am telling you, I didn't give all that. At the time of insemination and fertilization, we will discuss about that. Okay. A sperm can survive a maximum of 24 to 48 hours in female genital tract, but it can able to store in the epididymis up to a maximum of 1 month, 30 to 35 days. Okay, that you have to remember. But in female body or female genital tract, it can survive a maximum of 24 hours, or 24 to 48 hours is the maximum. Okay. So that is the lifespan of sperm in the female genital tract. Okay, we will discuss that at the time of discussing about the topic of fertilization. Okay, pre-fertilization events and post-fertilization events. In that, during the pre-fertilization event, I will give you that. Okay, a focus on these topics. Right. External genitalia in female is known as vulva or pudendum. Vulva or pudendum. In female, the external genitalia is known as vulva or pudendum. What are the parts in this vulva or pudendum? Already I gave you. Once again, write down this. The vulva or pudendum contains, it possesses mons pubis. Mons pubis. Below this. Or under this, there is a pair of fleshy folds of skin, wide fleshy folds of skin, that is known as labia majora. And inside this, or under this labia majora, there is small folds of skin, that is labia minora. Labia minora. So labia majora, labia minora, and here there is a erectile structure, clitoris and hymen. Already I gave you a partially perforated thin membrane that covers the vaginal opening or vaginal orifice. Is it clear? These are the external genitalia or pudendum or vulva. So what is external genitalia? You all know that External genitalia are externally visible parts of reproductive system which play an important role in the copulation. So here, mans pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris, and hymen are the parts in the vulva or pudendum of female reproductive system. Now we will discuss about all this in detail. Along with this, I will mention the locations of some accessory glands. Then we will discuss that immediately at that time only. Okay, right. So before going to discuss about all this in detail, take 5 minutes of break.
Now we will discuss same thing. That is external genitalia, and it is vulva pudendum here. What are the parts in the vulva pudendum? Mans pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris, and hymen. So now we will discuss about this. So here, observe here, the lady is a tangential demonstration of the pudendum. A cushion of fatty tissue located at the anterior most region of the pudendum. It is covered by skin and pubic hair. So here, it is mans pubis. A cushion of fatty tissue. Cushion of fatty tissue covered by skin and pubic hair is known as mans pubis. It is located at the uppermost region or at the uppermost region of the pudendum. There is a cushion of fatty tissue which is covered by skin and pubic hair is known as mans pubis. What is mans pubis? A cushion of fatty tissue covered by skin and pubic hair located at the uppermost region or anteriormost region of the pudendum or vulva is known as mans pubis. Mans pubis. It is also known as mans varinis, but remember this, mans pubis. Okay. Next, after mans pubis, what is the next structure here? Below this, mans pubis. There are two fleshy folds of skin arises. Fleshy, large or wide fleshy folds of skin arises here. From the below of this, like this. There are two large fleshy folds of skin. These two large fleshy folds of skin are known as labia majora. The two large fleshy folds of skin are labia majora. Okay. So the two labia majora there. These are the two labia majora. What is the area of mesora? The two fleshy folds of skin. So here, the two white fleshy folds of skin present below the mask pubis here, area of mesora. The two fleshy folds of skin which are located below the labia, below the mask pubis or labia mesora, these are five folds. Okay, the white fleshy folds of skin that are located below the mask pubis is labia mesora. Labia mesora. On the surface of this labia mesora, there are modified sebaceous glands present. So here are these sebaceous glands. That is used in labia mesora. Labia mesora. What is labia mesora? Right on of you. The two wider fleshy folds of skin formed out of lateral border. So the lateral border of pudendal is labia mesora. The two fleshy folds of skin which are wider and form the lateral margins of the pudendal, the lateral margins of the pudendal is known as labia mesora. This labia mesora can be, this labia mesora can be modified sebaceous glands. Modified sebaceous glands. So that's the thing about the labia mesora, right? So labia mesora, this labia mesora are two fleshy folds of skin that are that form the lateral margins of pudendal, and this possesses modified sebaceous glands, and these are large or wider folds of the skin. And inside this, there are two. Inside this, again there are two small folds of skin. These are the large folds of skin. Inside this, there are two small folds of skin. Two small folds of skin. These two small folds of skin are known as, these two small folds of skin, like this. Two small folds of skin, labia minora. Labia minora. So what is labia minora? The two small folds of skin located inside the labia mesora. The two small folds of skin located inside the labia minora, sorry, labia mesora or labia minora. So labia mesora completed. Labia mesora to large fleshy folds, large wider fleshy folds of skin that form the lateral margin of pudendal. But inside this labia mesora are two small fleshy folds, two small folds of skin which is known as labia minora. Right? Labia mesora completed, labia minora also completed. And after this labia mesora and labia minora, shall that be made run here? So labia minora. This is labia minora. Right? Inside this labia minora, you observe here. Inside labia minora, there is a space. These two are labia minora. Labia minora, and inside this labia minora, in between the two labia minora, this space is known as vestibule. vestibule. What is vestibule? The space between two labia minora. The space between two labia minora is known as vestibule. The space between two labia minora is known as vestibule. Right? Next. At the anterior most region of these two labia minora, And in between two linear bipolar, there is a space which is known as vestibule. Vestibule is a space that represents between two linear bipolar. And the clitoris, what is this clitoris? Clitoris is a tiny finger like erectile structure that located at the anterior margin of two linear bipolar. It is homologous to gland cells of male. In male reproductive system, at the tip of penis or at the posterior of penis, penis will bulge like a bulb, that is the gland cells. So here, structurally, clitoris and the gland cells are similar, but the function is different. So the organs which have similar structure but different function are known as homologous organs. So here, once again, I am giving you clitoris of female reproductive system is homologous to gland cells of male. What is homologous means? Homologous means structurally similar but functionally different. Right? So, the organs which are similar to the structure but differs in the function and give a simple definition for your understanding. Okay? Which are structurally similar but differs in function. So, here, clitoris of female is homologous to gland cells of male. Gland cells of male. But one more thing you have to remember here, in the male, the penis or gland cells has a passage, that is, the passes through your penis and gland cells. But here, there is no passage. Clitoris does not have any passage. Clitoris does not have any passage. There is no passage in the clitoris. There is no passage in the clitoris. That you have to remember this area. In the penis and gland cells, there is a passage that is related to the area of the penis. And after completion of it, I give you here vestibule. What is vestibule? What is vestibule? What is vestibule? So already I told you the space present in between two labia minora is vestibule. And this vestibule contains two openings. Just below the clitoris, here, there is a small opening. And below, here there is a large opening, that is vaginal arteries or vaginal opening. So if you observe here, there are two openings in the vestibule. So below the clitoris there is no opening, it is the opening of urethra. So it is a urethral opening or urethral meatus or urethral orifice. So there is a urethral opening or urethral orifice. And here there is a vaginal opening at posterior. At posterior end, there is a vaginal opening. Okay. So it is vaginal orifice. Vaginal orifice. Vaginal orifice. Is it clear? So vestibule contains two openings. One is urethral orifice and urethral opening. Okay. Is it clear? All of you? Are you listening my voice? Is it clear now? Okay. Observe. Okay. Right? Observe. Listen. Right. Is it okay? Right. So observe here. There are two openings in the vestibule. One is vaginal opening, and one is urethral opening. See, the urethral opening or urethral arteries opens below the clitoris. But at the posterior end, there is a large opening with vaginal opening. So vestibule has two openings. The upper region, there is a urethral opening. Through this urethra opening. So that you have to remember here. After opening is opening. Clear? So once again, what we discussed here up to now, I'm repeating. We discussed about vulva system. In this, mass pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris. All the four structures I gave you, and with that I give you vestibule also. What is mass pubis here? Is mons pubis. Is it here? What is mons pubis? A question of fatty tissue. A question of fatty tissue covered by skin and pubic hair. A question of fatty tissue. Question of fatty tissue or the skin and pubic hair. A question of fatty tissue covered by skin and once again, listen, what is mons pubis? A cushion of fatty tissue. A cushion of fatty tissue covered by skin and pubic hair. Cushion of fatty tissue covered by skin and pubic hair. A question of fatty tissue covered by skin and pubic hair is known as mons pubis. Mons pubis. So below this mons pubis, there are a pair of large fold of skin. A pair of large fold of skin. Inside this area of visceral, there are two small folds of skin that are known as labia minora. In between two labia minora, there is space that is known as vestibule. Vestibule is a space present between two labia minora. And in this vestibule, there are two openings. One upper opening and one lower opening. The upper opening is lateral orifice or lateral opening. The lower opening is vaginal orifice or vaginal opening. Is it clear? Right. But at the anterior margin of control area minora, there is a tiny finger like erectile organ, which is clitoris. Right. And one more thing you have to remember here. Vestibule possesses two openings. One is for the excretory system and one is for the reproductive system. The opening of excretory system is the lateral orifice and the opening of the reproductive system is the lateral orifice. So, if you observe these two, there is no connection between the excretory system and the reproductive system. But whereas in nail protrusion system, urethra is the one consists of both the sedentary and the ureters. But here there are two separate openings. One is for expression of urine entropies from reproductive activities. Okay, so female reproductive system is not considered as a inconsumable tract. Urethra in female reproductive system is not considered as a urinoconsumable tract. It is not a urinoconsumable tract. It is purely urinary tract only. It's only the expression that cannot play any role in the reproductive process, right? That's clear. And one more thing now, I told you associated glands also located along with this vulva organ. What are associated glands that are located inside the vestibules? Are they giving you? Glands and lesser vestibular glands. In this, observe here carefully, on the inner side of the vaginal opening, there is a pair of large glands that are known as greater vestibular glands. So, how many greater vestibular glands are present? A pair of greater vestibular glands are present on either side of vaginal opening. On either side of vaginal opening, there are a pair of, so here, there are a pair of greater vestibular glands. Greater vestibular glands are present on either side of the vaginal opening. This greater vestibular glands are also known as Pertolis glands. Already I gave you Pertolis glands are greater vestibular glands. So many Pertolis glands are there. There are a pair of greater vestibular or Pertolis glands are present. A pair of greater vestibular or Pertolis glands are present here. Understood? And around this greater opening, there are numerous of minute glands. Small minute glands are present around the greater opening. Minute glands are present around the greater opening that are known as lesser vestibular glands. Lesser, because these are small insides, so located inside the vestibules. So these are vestibular glands. These two types of glands are located in the vestibule. So these are vestibular glands. Which are large in size are greater vestibular glands. Which are small in size are lesser vestibular glands. Lesser vestibular glands. Greater vestibular glands and lesser vestibular glands. This lesser vestibular glands are also Skene's glands. Are glands of Skene. Skene's glands are glands of Skene. So here, the space present between two labia minora is known as vestibule. The space present between two labia minora is known as vestibule. And this vestibule has two openings. The outer opening is urethral opening and the opening is vaginal opening. On either side of vaginal opening, there are a pair of large vestibular glands which are known as urethral vestibular glands or Pertolis glands. And around this present urethral opening, there are minute, small, numerous glands are there that are lesser vestibular glands. Glands. The location of accessory glands. Two types of accessory glands are located in the vestibule. The smaller are lesser vestibular Skene's glands, which are numerous, and the larger are greater vestibular or Pertolis glands, which are one pair. Only one pair is present, right? And what is the role of this greater vestibular? Great vessel vestibular glands here. The great vestibular gland secretes some sticky alkaline fluids. Sticky alkaline fluids. So here, this sticky fluid helps in the lubrication during the copulation. During the copulation only, this gland secretes some secretions. That secretions are alkaline in nature and act as lubricants. The secretions of great vestibular glands are propolis glands. Act as a lubricants. That act as a lubricants. So the secretions of great vestibular glands are the propolis glands. They act as a lubricant and reduces the friction during the copulation. And one more thing, the secretes alkaline fluids, which helps in the neutralizing of acidic medium of vagina during copulation. To neutralize acidic medium of vagina during copulation, the secretions of Bartholin's glands, greater vestibular glands are useful. And also, these fluids act as a lubricant, so that reduces the friction with the copulation. Reduces the friction during the copulation. Actually, these Bartholin's glands are homologous to multiple glands of the reproductive system. Bartholin's glands are homologous to the glands of the reproductive system. Bulbourethral glands are Cowper's glands. Bulbourethral glands are Cowper's glands. Very important one. Bartholin's glands are female reproductive system are homologous to bulbourethral glands of male reproductive system. So Bartholin's glands are homologous to bulbourethral glands. That you have to remember. Homologous means there are structurally similar but diversity function. Bulbourethral glands and Bartholin's glands are homologous to each other. So the Bartholin glands of female reproductive system are homologous to bulbourethral glands of male reproductive system. Right? And here, Steele's glands are lesser vestibular glands. The lesser vestibular glands of Steele's glands are homologous to prostate gland of male reproductive system. Okay? So, Bartholin's glands are homologous to bulbourethral glands of male reproductive system. Are homologous glands of male reproductive system. Okay. Bartholin's glands are homologous to bulbourethral glands of male reproductive system. Whereas Steele's glands are lesser vestibular glands are homologous to prostate gland. Lesser vestibular glands are homologous to prostate gland. That also we have to remember, right? That also we should observe here. And many homologous structures are there between male and female reproductive system. There are many homologous structures. Now I will give you which are homologous to which are the in male and female reproductive systems. Okay. So here, the homologous organs of male and female reproductive system. Homologous structures are homologous organs of male and female reproductive system here. See here, in female, this structure is homologous to male reproductive system. Here, in the female, these are the homologous elements in male and female. See first, labia majora of female reproductive system is homologous to scrotum of male. Labia majora of female reproductive system is homologous to scrotum of male. Clitoris of female reproductive system. Clitoris of female reproductive system is homologous to glance image of male, glance image of male. Next, labia minora, labia minora of female reproductive system is homologous to penile labia of male. Homologous to membranous membranous urethra. And already I told you the Bartholin's glands of male reproductive system are homologous to bulbourethral glands. Bartholin's glands are greater. Visceral glands are homologous to Pauper's glands are bulbourethral glands. Pauper's glands are bulbourethral glands. Bartholin's glands are homologous to Pauper's glands are bulbourethral glands. And here you see the lesser visceral glands or Skene's glands are homologous to Pauper's glands. So here I gave you the hormonal structures present in male and female reproductive system. See, the area minora of female reproductive system is homologous to sclera of male reproductive system. The clitoris of female reproductive system is homologous to glans salivales. The area minora is homologous to penile urethra. The vestibule of female reproductive system is homologous to membranous urethra. The Bartholin's glands are greater visceral glands are homologous to Pauper's glands or bulbourethral glands of the reproductive system. Lesser visceral glands or Skene's glands of female reproductive system is homologous to prostate gland of male reproductive system. So that we have to remember here. Up to then, the external genitalia of female reproductive system is completed. The external genitalia poses vast pubis. Actually, this non-pubic sac adhesion of adipic tissue during the maturation, whenever pubic symphysis relaxes, and this will support the pubic symphysis. So it has a role to reduce more pressure on pubic symphysis during the maturation. Okay, that is non-pubic. And after that, labia minora forms the hormone. There are two small folds of skin, that is labia minora. In between two labia minora, there is a space which is known as vestibule. This vestibule contains two openings. Upper opening is urethral opening. Lower urethral opening is vaginal opening. And around this urethral opening, there are numerous of small glands are present, which are known as lesser vestibular glands or Skene's glands. These lesser vestibular glands or Skene's glands are homologous to prostate gland of male. And these lesser vestibular glands or Skene's glands secrete mucus. What is the function of these lesser vestibular glands or Skene's glands? Secretion of mucus. The secretes mucus. All of the greater vestibular glands are Bartholin's glands. The vein of Bartholin's glands are greater vestibular glands are located on either side of the vaginal opening, and these glands are homologous to bulbourethral glands or Pauper's glands of male reproductive system. And these glands secrete some alkaline and sticky fluids during the copulation that reduces the friction during the copulation, and also that helps in the replacement of acidic disease. Okay, so that's clear. And one more thing you have to remember here. I gave you here one of the homologous structures in male and female resistance, right? Now one more thing you have to observe here. So here two type of plants are complicated. The necessary plant mass later we will do plant complicated. This is which the plant also complicated. Later which the plant will be complicated. Now, you observe it here. At the posterior end, the two layers of membrane are fused. At posterior end, the two layers of membrane are fused. Right? That is observed. On the margin of two layers of membrane at posterior end, is known as four gene. What is four gene? The two four gene margin. So here, what is the two layer membrane margin? The two gene. The two layers are fused at posterior end, like this. At posterior end, the two layers are fused. So that is known as posterior. That is posterior. That is posterior. The two layers are fused at posterior end. So the two labia minora are fused at posterior end, which is known as posterior end. So it is a margin of two labia minora at posterior end. At posterior end, the two labia minora are fused, and that the fused structure of the margin is known as posterior important. That is posterior end. The two labia minora are fused at posterior end. That is known as posterior end. The two labia minora are fused at posterior end, and this margin at posterior end where the two labia minora are fused is known as posterior. And if so, in between this posterior and anus, it is the anus. It is a posterior anus and posterior. In between anus and posterior, there is a space, or there is a vertical line, or there is a vertical fold of tissue. So the vertical fold of tissue, which is present between posterior and the anus, is called as perineum. 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 So the vertical fold of tissue present between posterior and anus. In between posterior and anus, there is a vertical fold in between posterior and the anus. This vertical fold, the vertical fold of tissue present between posterior and anus is known as perineum. So posterior and perineum also what is posterior? What is posterior? So here at posterior end, the two labia minora are fused, and this fused margin is known as posterior. Because of between posterior and anus, there is a vertical fold of tissue. There is a vertical fold of tissue, or the space which is present between posterior and anus. The space which is present between posterior and anus is known as perineum. It is known as perineum. So perineum. Here, what is perineum? The place present between posterior and anus is perineum, or vertical fold of tissue which is present between posterior and anus is perineum. Perineum. Is it clear about perineum? What is perineum? The fold between the vertical fold of tissue between posterior and anus is perineum, right? So that is about the external genitalia to of internal rotor system. Along with that, we discussed the external bench area and some accessory clamps also. We discussed here. We gave you two accessory clamps also here. We discussed about the uterus. In the uterus, what are the parts? There is the fundus, corona, and corpus. In the wall of the uterus, there are three layers: outer layer is perimedium, middle layer is myometrium, and the layer is endometrium. Perimedium is outer protective, it is serosa lactatia. Middle one is a muscular layer, that is the myometrium. And the other one is a glandular layer of which is the
lesser vestibular glands are skin glands, which is the mucus. Thank you.